Hello friends, in this session we are going to discuss something about summation notation. You would have seen this notation used extensively in statistics and functions and matrices and other places. So let us give you a little overview of what exactly this notation is and how its properties are like. So what is summation notation? You have come across this sign sigma. So it is a Greek letter. It's called sigma. It's capital sigma in Greek. And it is shorthand for addition of a sequence of any kind of numbers. Okay, so let us say if you pay attention to this particular sequence, these are x1, x2, x3, x4. Let us say there are these many xn numbers. So there are, let's say, n numbers, and you want to use them in your literature, or let's say while communicating. So it will be very cumbersome to write x1, x2, x3, x4 and so on. Let's say n is 1000. So to write 1000 variables like this will become very cumbersome. So hence we use a shorthand, and this is our notation for that. So I'll also explain sideways. So if you see in this example one, where the x1, x2, x3 to xn are numbers in a sequence, and then that is notified as sigma sign, like this sigma, and there is this letter I, which is the counter, or we call it as index as well. So I goes from 1 and ends up at n. What does it mean when I say I goes from 1 to n? So I, the value of I will change incrementally. So I will be first 1, then 2, add 1 to 1, then add 1 to 2, you'll get 3, then 4, then 5, likewise till I value becomes n, right? And then this is xi. So what would it mean? It means that you have to start from x, and instead of I, first I, you write 1, which is this one, okay? Then add a plus sign, then write x, and then the second subscript. This part is called subscript. This is subscript. Okay, so the second subscript will be 2, right? And then again add, write 3, and keep on doing this till you add all the xi's till xn, right? An example will make it more clear. So let us say in this second example, before that, few definitions. So I is index of summation. You can see that I is equal to 1 is the lower limit, xi is the variable, ni is equal to n is the upper limit. Okay, so let us see this in example 2. So if you see, I is varying from 7 to 10. Now yi, that means first value of I will be 7, then add to it y8, that means I value has become 8, then it is y9, and then finally y10, because you will not write y11 because I maximum upper limit is 10. Okay, so this is what example 2 says. Example 3, if you see, I is equal to 1 to I is equal to n, summation I. Okay, summation I means the value of I will keep on changing. Like first I value is 1, so I have written 1. Then the second term will be 2, the next I. The third value of I is 3, then 4, then 5, likewise till n minus 1, and finally n. So this is sum of first n natural numbers. Now come to example 4. Here it is I equals to 3 to I equals to 6. So you might be thinking, why is I not starting from 1? So I can have any value, starting value, till it is lesser than the upper limit, right? But upper limit has to be more than lower limit. Now if you, this is a summation I square, that means first value of I is 3, so 3 is squared. Then next value of I is 4, so 4 squared, 5 squared, and finally 6 squared. You will not be writing 7 squared because the upper limit of I is 6. Now let us understand some properties of summation operator. So here I have mentioned I is equal to 1 to n summation Cxi, where C is a constant and Xi is the variable, right? So the idea, or the left hand side of this particular equation, says that it is Cx1 plus Cx2 plus Cx3, so on and so forth till Cxn. So what can you do? You can take C common and you can write x1 plus x2 plus so on and so forth till xn, Now this is c times nothing but, what is x1, x2, x3, xn we just saw above? So this is nothing but xi, where I is varying from 1 to n. Okay, I is equal to n. Example for this would be, let us say you have 2xi and I is equal to, let's say, 1 to 10. So it will be nothing but 2 times summation xi, I is equal to 1 to 10. Okay, first one. Now let us understand this particular example. So here are two variables, x and y's, and they are varying. So hence LHS of that will give you what? So one I first value is 1. So x1, y1. Then it goes to x2 plus y2. Then x3 plus y3 and so on so forth till xn plus yn. Now you can rearrange them to write as x1 plus x2, all x together, xn plus y1 plus y2 plus all y's together, right? Now the first, this term is nothing but summation xi, and I is varying from where to where? 1 to I is equal to n. And the second term is nothing but summation yi, and I is varying from 1 to, isn't it? Now third one also follows. So instead of plus, there is minus. So here it will become minus simply, right? So second and third are quite similar. So what do we learn? So if there is summation on two variables together, so we can split it into two summations. First on the first variable and second on the second variable. Similarly, if there is difference, if the summation on difference of two variables, then that is equal to summation of first one minus summation of the second variable. Yeah, there are a few more properties of summation operator, but that those will be more relevant in, let's say, topic under functions and matrices and other things. So we'll stop here. These three properties are good enough for you to understand the concepts of statistics, basic statistics of elementary level. Thank you.